Tonight, this is our first week in our new teaching series called How to Be Rich. Woohoo! So I imagine there are a few distinct reactions to that. Some people might think, yes, finally a message I can use. And other people might be thinking, that makes me a little uncomfortable. Because I didn't think being a Christian was about being rich. I thought it was more about following Jesus regardless of what my circumstances are. So if you had that first reaction, then I'm afraid to tell you that this sermon series might disappoint you. And if you want to learn how to manage your finances better, then I highly recommend the Dave Ramsey Financial Peace Course, which is going on now. And that will be a course that will help you manage better the money that you have. But that's not going to be the focus of this teaching series. And if you were thinking that how to be rich is a topic that makes you uncomfortable as a part of a preaching message, well then I'm with you. And I want to clear up a few things at the beginning of our teaching series. There are some preachers, some Christian preachers out there that do preach a prosperity gospel message. Sometimes it's called the gospel of success, where they say, if you are good enough and do all the right things, God is gonna love you so much and God's gonna give you everything your heart desires, money and wealth and maybe fame and definitely a great body and anything that you want and popularity and on and on and on and on, everything you desire. There are some Christian preachers that do say that, but in the Lutheran Christian tradition, we would say that was the misguided theology of glory. Lutheran Christians find themselves in the category of Christians where we believe that Jesus' death on the cross for our sins defines everything for us. We can never be good enough and perfect enough to earn God's love. The only thing we can do is just to say thank you to God in how we live our lives, because God has loved us so unconditionally and has chosen to forgive our sins. I have a few slides to show you that kind of show the difference between where we come from as Lutheran Christians and where a few other people come from. The theology of glory is the one that says, you're going to be rich if you follow these things. And Lutheran Christians follow the theology of the cross. In the theology of glory, you will hear that faith is the means to gain material success. And then in the theology of the cross, you hear being a Christian is being faithful to Christ regardless of the cost. In the theology of glory, you might hear being a Christian will make your life better in a material sense. But in the theology of the cross, being a Christian will not necessarily make your life better in a worldly or material sense. And in the theology of glory, you might hear, God helps those who help themselves. Did you know that's not even in the Bible? A lot of people think that that's actually in the Bible. I think Ben Franklin said it. So it's not actually in the Bible. But in the theology of the cross, we hear Jesus' words, take up your cross and follow me. In the theology of glory, people try to win souls by convincing people to buy the message of Christianity, and it's kind of a sales pitch for being a Christian. Whereas in the theology of the cross, we make disciples by sharing the good news of how God changes lives. We consider ourselves more news announcers, saying, this is what God has done for us. This is amazing. In the theology of glory, you might hear, if you do this for God, if you do something really great for God, God's going to do something really great for you. And it's kind of a transaction. Whereas in the theology of the cross, you hear, this is what God has already done for you. And it's our job to just say thank you in how we live. The theology of glory says, we climb up to heaven on the road to glory because of our actions, our good works, all the good things we do. But in the theology of the cross, we say we are stewards of God's gifts. That means we don't own any of these things. We're just taking care of them. They're gifts from God that we can use. And in the theology of glory, You might keep hearing, your eternal reward is coming. There's going to be a big reward for you. And in the theology of the cross, we hear God's free gift of grace has been given to you already. And that's something that we can be thankful about. So that is your crash course in understanding where we're coming from. And now on to our series of How to Be Rich. We got this title from a reading from 1 Timothy. And Paul writes to Timothy and says, teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and generous to those in need, always ready to share with others. So this is where we get the teaching message, the title for this teaching series. We're not preaching a message of how to get more. We're teaching a message of how to give more, because God has already been so rich towards us. And since Paul is giving this advice to Timothy in this New Testament book, there must be a reason for it. There must have been people who were rich, who were maybe a little high on themselves. Maybe they were kind of proud of themselves. Maybe they were putting their hope in their money and not their hope in God. Maybe it was just to remind those who were rich to have a healthy perspective and not to be insulating themselves from the needs of others and continuing to share with others. Maybe it was just a healthy precautionary advice. But I think Paul is reminding them what true riches are. And to be rich in serving others, be rich in giving your time, be rich in sharing with those in need. And do this because God is so generous towards you. So this teaching series will not be about how we can become financially wealthy, but we will be talking about finances throughout this series. And it is an uncomfortable topic because in polite company, there's some topics we're not supposed to bring up. We're not supposed to bring up politics, religion, sex, or how much money someone makes. Those are just not things we do. But we're going to be talking about money tonight because this isn't polite company. This is family. This is church family. What better place to bring up those topics that we are not allowed to bring up other places? So did you know that you are all rich and I am rich too? Did you know we are really very rich? That if you make $48,000 a year, you are in the top 1% of wage earners in the world. If you make $48,000 a year. Now I know you might not think, well, that doesn't sound rich. Some people might think, well, I make way more than that. That's nothing. And others might think, yeah, that sounds about average. That's about where I'm at. And others might think, oh, if only I could make $48,000, that would really make me a lot more stable and secure in my living. But no matter where you would think of this, you don't think $48,000 is just filthy, stinking rich, and jet planes and private islands and all of that. But by worldly standards, $48,000 is wealthy. And I included on the back of your bulletin an at-home challenge. You can go to globalrichlist.com and type in your annual income, and it will tell you where you sit in comparison with other wage earners in the world. And it will actually give you a ranking of, like, you are the 758,000th richest person in the world. And so you can go do that either on your smartphone right now or when you get home. But let me give you an idea of what being rich is. You're rich if you have shelter for your car, otherwise known as a garage. You are rich if you have an extra bedroom for guests, or just an extra bedroom to put all the clutter that you can't fit anywhere else. You are rich if you walk or run for exercise, and not just for transportation. I think that would put all of us in the category of being rich. And I think that we just don't like to admit it, we don't know how to talk about it, but we do have a lot of riches. And the reason I bring this up is because I think that advice that Paul gave to Timothy, that I read to you from that letter, 1 Timothy, I think that advice is really for us too. By worldly standards, we are rich, and I think we need those reminders about how to live richly towards others. And also that story that I shared with you from Mark chapter 12, where Jesus was teaching his disciples, that demonstrates this also. Sometimes we call this story the widow's mite or the widow's offering. And I wonder if anybody would be brave enough to tell me the moral of this story as you've heard it before. What's the moral of the story where all these rich people are putting in lots of money and this widow puts in two little coins? You know, you were here before. You heard this. You heard the sermon on Sunday. I want to see if somebody else would be brave. What's the moral of the story of the widow's mite? Well, that's a good moral. No matter how much you make, continue to give to the Lord. Yes. Any other ways that you've remembered this story, the moral of this story? Okay, you were here too. No, I can't let you say it. I can't let you say it. Yes.
She truly made a sacrifice.
She truly made a sacrifice. But, and that's how I've heard it too. I've heard, let's all be like the widow, because she gives everything. She gives it all. But I learned of a new way to look at this story when over the last summer I led an all-city women's Bible study where women from all over Moorhead came and met here for Bible study. And the Bible study resources I used were by a woman named Emma Croson, and she had a new way to look at this story. She says, Jesus doesn't actually praise the widow. He doesn't knock her. He's not trying to disparage her in any way. But he's not praising her. He's not saying, blessed be this widow. He might just be pointing her out to show how the religious system of his day was broken. That there were people giving their very last pennies, sacrificing to the point of having nothing. And yet all that money was going to those religious leaders who were walking around in their long robes and who were just getting high off of being respected and well thought of. And all these poor people gave, and these rich leaders kept getting richer, and they weren't actually being faithful to God and weren't actually looking out for the needs of people like this widow. If you remember, I told you how Jesus was just talking to this crowd of people saying, notice how the scribes are living. They're doing all these terrible things, and they devour widows' houses, and then they say really long prayers just to make themselves look good. And then he looks up, and he sees a widow demonstrating that point of giving her last pennies. Maybe when we hear this story, we've been putting our emphasis and our focus on the wrong place. Maybe instead of saying, we should be sacrificing like the widow, maybe it's a message to all of us who have means to say, how are we using our money? Are we actually using it to help others? Are we actually using it to walk with people who are poor, who are in need, who have been abused, who have been neglected? Are we actually being the church family that they need? Or are we ignoring them and just getting fat and sassy ourselves? Maybe the focus of this story is really on how we have been entrusted with these gifts, and the way that we use them, the way that we spend them, should be to make sure that we are caring for the people who are in the most need. Now you might think that if you look at this story this way, that I am saying, don't give any money to church or to any worthy causes. That would kind of not go very well with the message of this loaves and fishes challenge that we've been a part of. What I'm really saying is, yes, please share your resources here with this ministry, but also be involved, be invested. Hold us all accountable together to make sure that we are spending these resources in a way that is taking care of people who are in need, taking care of people who have been hurt, people who are vulnerable, making sure that the way we do ministry here, make sure that we are walking together with those who are struggling and hurting. And so that when we pool our resources together, beautiful things are happening in Jesus' name. And that our witness to the world is, look at that group of people and how they're caring for one another and how they are caring for people who desperately need to be cared for. If we are paying attention to what Jesus pays attention to, then we will have our eyes on the needs of the poor, on the needs of the abused, on the needs of the hurting. And by us focusing outward on those needs, we are rich then. We are rich in love. We are rich in kindness. We are rich in generosity. That's what it means to be rich. Amen.